So in this presentation, I will emphasize the evolution of philosophic, conceptual, theoretical, and empirical challenges that have been encountered by the members of our discipline since at least the time of Florence Nightingale in the middle 1800s, and I would say since the time of the founding of Les Sources, which I understand was even before Florence Nightingale. So I'm really excited to be able to bring that knowledge back to my colleagues in Massachusetts, that we've always thought that Florence Nightingale was the founder, but I think the countess that founded Les Sources is really the founder of what we would call modern nursing. So these are some definitions. Evolution refers to transitions over time, a process of gradual change in development of a subject, typically from relatively simple to more complex subject matter. And the challenge is the questioning or disputing current thinking about subject matter. So this is what I have come to call in the last few years the name of our discipline. And we've had a lot of very interesting dialogue throughout the week of how we translate the word nursology into other language and specifically into French. And I proposed, at the risk of offending everyone, that maybe what we need to do to start is to call it nursology and then over time think of a new word rather than a literal translation of the term. And the reason I'm thinking about calling us nursology is that for very political reasons, it puts us on the same level as the other disciplines like biology and psychology and sociology and so on. And I think that that's really important to do. So even if we don't find a word to replace or to translate nursology into other languages, if we just think about us as an ology. And the word was first introduced in nursing, as far as I know, by Josephine Patterson in an article she wrote in 1971. And she said essentially that the study of nursology is the study of nursing aimed toward the development of nursing theory. And I think that's really, really important that we think about what we're about is developing theory. And we can do that as practicing nurses as well as researchers. And then we can call ourselves nursologists. And Patterson and her colleague Zerdad actually did have positions in a hospital in New York where they were called nursologists for a time. So even if you think that this is a pretty wild idea, what I would encourage you to do is to share the idea with your friends and colleagues and family members and see what people say. So some of my students are doing that. Some of our freshman students are doing that. And they come back with, well, you know, it's something to think about. So nursologists would be all the members of the discipline of nursology, including clinicians, researchers, educators, and administrators. And if we think about and take apart the word, you know, ology comes from the Latin that has to do with understanding or knowledge. So we're really talking about what the knowledge of nursing is. And Daniel, if you could switch the slide. So Daniel's going to switch to a graphic of this that comes from the N papers in a book called The Short History of Nursing, published in 1938 by Lavinia Dock and Isabel Stewart. And when I discovered this some years ago, I thought it was one of the best things that I've ever seen in my career. So what we see here is, in terms of the evolution of nursologists, who were the nurses? And so originally, the nurses were considered primitive mothers and then wise women of essentially prehistoric times. And then we've evolved over time, as you can see, to male and female members of religious orders. And so the people who cared for people who needed nursing were primarily members of religious orders, and it transitioned at times from women to men. And then later on, we see that there were barber surgeons, which makes me pretty nervous, but they were. And then we saw a transition again to male and female members of religious orders, and eventually to the modern professional nurse, starting with Florence Nightingale and the nurses here at Les Sources. And most recently, we're evolving to advanced practice nurses and research nurses. Let me go back to the slide. I had asked my technology person to incorporate that file into my PowerPoints, and he said he couldn't do it, so I apologize for that. So when I'm talking about advanced practice nurses from the perspective of the United States, we are moving, hopefully more rapidly than we are right now, but we're moving rather rapidly from master's degree preparation to preparation of advanced practice nurses at the Doctor of Nursing Practice level. And it would be quite possible to go from a bachelor's degree to a Doctor of Nursing Practice program. And different programs have admission criteria, whether you need to have a year or two or more of practice before you do that. Most recently, because so many nurses are prepared as master's prepared advanced practice nurses, in the United States, advanced practice nurses encompass nurse practitioners, clinical nurse specialists, nurse midwives, and nurse anesthetists. And some Doctor of Nursing Practice programs also prepare nurse educators and nurse administrators. But according to our accrediting body, advanced practice nurses are the nurse practitioners and so on. And then research nurses are nurses who have PhDs. And what can happen then is that with a bachelor's degree, you can choose a career in practice and then study for a Doctor of Nursing Practice degree, or you can, from a baccalaureate degree, bachelor's degree, study for, to decide that you want to be a research nurse and study for the PhD. So you don't have to have advanced practice preparation to go on to be a researcher. Of course, you can be one and then decide to do the other if you want to stay in school for even longer. So what are the philosophic challenges? Well, philosophies are statements encompassing ontological claims about phenomena of central interest to a discipline, epistemic claims about how that knowledge comes to be known, and ethical claims about what the members of a discipline value. And research paradigms are philosophies about the methods used to study and interpret the phenomena that are of interest to a discipline. The evolution of research paradigms encompasses a progression from the from positivism to post-positivism to interpretive paradigm, which includes constructionism, transformational emancipation, critical realism, and dialectic paradigms, and then to critical theory, to pragmatism. An analysis of the contemporary nursological research indicates that all of these paradigms are used as philosophic perspectives, although probably positivism is the least frequently used today. So we're continuing to use all of these different paradigms. So positivism is also known as the received view, or the Vienna Circle, and the goal was to obtain objective, generalizable theory established and developed deductively through formal statistical testing of hypotheses. The emphasis was on confirmation of theories. So if the theory is not confirmed, it was thought that the research was not conducted properly. So that gets you into a lot of trouble, because especially in the behavioral sciences and in the human sciences, because many, many, many of our theories, many, many of our hypotheses are not supported, or at least not wholly, not completely. And so if it turns out that your hypothesis was not supported, then it means that you're a poor researcher, as opposed to the theory not being a good theory. So that gets us into a lot of trouble when we don't support our theories. And it also is a major political problem. Because I once knew somebody who was using a different paradigm, not in nursing, but another discipline, and it wasn't what the other members of the discipline in her department thought should be done, and so she didn't get tenure. even though her work was very well respected, but not by that particular group of people. So then if we evolve toward positivism, we recognize that the theory is only the starting point for research rather than only the end point. And it's thought of as theory laden. We hear that term in the literature from time to time. And this emphasizes deduction and quantitative data, precise instrumentation, and statistical testing. But the emphasis is on falsification of the theory. And this comes primarily from Karl Popper's philosophy of science. And his point was that, first of all, that everybody has a frame of reference, or what we've come to call conceptual models. But then if you refute your theory, in other words, if you don't support your hypotheses, that's a really good thing. So inasmuch as I've hardly ever had to been able to support my hypotheses, I'm very much of a Popperian. And I discovered his philosophy of science when I was a doctoral student, like 43 or 44 years ago. And I thought, finally, I found something that's going to save me in terms of being able to understand my findings and not think I'm a total failure as a researcher. So it becomes very very helpful to those of us who don't have much success in supporting our hypotheses. Because what Popper is saying is that when you falsify your hypothesis or you falsify your theory, you'll come up with a better one. So it's always an evolving process of finding a better hypothesis, finding a better theory. And that's a good thing. An interpretive research paradigm, as I noted earlier, is associated with constructivism, critical realism, and dialectics. And essentially what we're talking about is the work of Heidegger and other phenomenologists and interpretive scientists who focus on essentially the lived or living experiences, and from the perspective of the research participant rather than from our own perspective. So positivism and post-positivism, by and large, is from the researcher's perspective, whereas if you're doing research within the context of an interpretive paradigm, then you're coming at it from the perspective of the person. And what is that person's lived, or the more recent term I've been seeing in the literature, especially associated with Rosemary Parsi's work, is the living experience, the idea that you're continuing to live that. Critical social theory is primarily from Marx and Habermas and Fieri, and the focus is on countering oppression. So this is a very political perspective, and focusing on class and gender, and the theory and the experience is shaped by social, political, cultural, gender, and economic factors. So rather than saying that this is just the way it is, critical social theory really puts it into a context, and feminism puts it into the context of very much of a feminist perspective, which tends to leave out the men in the world, which may or may not be a good thing. And then transformation and emancipation is really on essentially community involvement in the research. And so some of my colleagues do participatory action research, which involves the community in essentially shaping the research questions and shaping how the research data are to be collected and how the data are to be interpreted. And pragmatism is essentially from the classical pragmatists such as Charles Peirce and William James and John Dewey. And here it's used to determine practical solutions and meanings. So that probably a lot of us are using a pragmatic approach. I tend to think of myself as a post-positivist, but when I read more about pragmatism, I thought probably that's in many ways what I'm doing, and probably a lot of us do that. And ultimately, pragmatism is regarded as the methodology best suited to answering research questions rather than conforming to a particular methodologic orthodoxy. So it's like, what is the best method for this particular question, which makes a lot of sense to me. So those are some of the philosophic challenges as I understand them. And we have to decide what we're doing, I think it's really important to identify which research paradigm you're using, at least to be aware of that and to follow that paradigm in terms of what you're doing. I think a fair number of researchers do that. We don't necessarily say that we're doing that or write that we're doing it, but we know that. So then we want to look at conceptual models of nursology as conceptual challenges. So here we think about, or I think at least, about a conceptual model as a set of abstract and general concepts and propositions about phenomena that are of interest to the discipline, and specifically for us, to nursologists. And I mentioned Popper before, and he indicated that we always have a frame of reference. We always have what I think of as a conceptual model. Some people refer to conceptual models as paradigms. And when I was writing some of my books about conceptual models of nursing, at one point I said to my editor at my publisher that I'd really like to change the title of the book to Paradigms. And she said, well, it's already established as conceptual models. So we've been kind of stuck with that term. And I got the term from one of the earliest books on conceptual models by Joan Real and Calista Roy. So we've continued to use that term, but in a lot of other disciplines, these perspectives are understood as paradigms. And so anyway, Popper indicated that everybody has a frame of reference, what he called a horizon of expectation. And so we've gone from Florence Nightingale and precursors of Florence Nightingale to what Dorothy Riley wrote in 1975 of private images of nursing, which continue to this day. So if I'm practicing, and perhaps Sandra's practicing, Daniel's practicing, and Maya's practicing, and we don't say which conceptual model we're using, we have no idea what the other person is doing. And suppose all four of us are taking care of the same patient over a period of a few days. The patient most likely is going to get caught in the middle. Each of us is going to be asking different questions when we're doing assessments. Each of us is possibly doing different interventions. And the patient's going to say, don't you people know what you're doing? And we start wondering, and our nurse administrators start wondering, why is there not continuity of care? Well, how can there be continuity of care if we're not all, as the expression goes, on the same page? So hopefully that makes some sense. So then what we want to do is what we have done, is develop explicit conceptual models of nursology. And we've done that reasonably well. We have many of them in the United States that are used in other countries. And then I'm learning over time that other countries have their own conceptual models, which I think is a good thing, because certainly the United States doesn't have the answer to all of nursing, and as it's viewed in other countries. But I think the most important thing is that we actually use a conceptual model to guide our practice. And so then the next challenge is for all of us to accept the idea of conceptual models, and then for all of us to finally use the conceptual models. So I've already pretty much mentioned all of this, but Many nurse theorists have developed conceptual models of nursing, and the ones that I'm most familiar with are Dorothy Johnson's behavioral system model, Imogen King's conceptual system, Myra Levine's conservation model, Betty Newman's systems model, which I know is used a little bit in Belgium and a lot in the Netherlands, Dorothy Oram's self-care framework, which I understand has been used quite a bit in Germany. And given what Jacques and other people have told me about Switzerland, it may be a very appropriate model for care in this country, where you focus very much on the individual and the individual's ability to care for self, and when not, then other people get involved. And then Martha Rogers' Science of Unitary Human Beings, and Calista Roy's adaptation model. So we need to move all of us. I mean, I think that this is perhaps the major challenge of nursology today and into the future, is that we accept the idea of conceptual models, that these exist, that they constitute a large part of the body of knowledge that makes up our discipline, and then use those conceptual models. And I would submit that if we don't do that, then we have no right to call ourselves a profession or a discipline, because the conceptual models, and then we'll learn a little bit more about theories, constitute the body of knowledge that is nursology, or nursing if you prefer that term. And if we reject that or don't bother with it or say they're not important, then we're saying we don't have a body of knowledge. And by definition, a discipline includes a distinctive body of knowledge, as does a profession. So if we say we're not interested in conceptual models, we're not interested in theories of our own especially, then how can we say that we're a discipline, and how can we claim the political right to call ourselves a discipline and to have all the rights and responsibilities and privileges that go with being a discipline or profession? So I see this as a perhaps our major challenge and our biggest stumbling block in my country as well as other places I've been. So I think that somebody needs to take the lead, and maybe those of you in Switzerland will do that. So if we progress on to theoretical challenges, we've gone from what people refer to as atheoretical work, but following from Popper, I would say that it's impossible to do atheoretical work. We always have some sort of a theory. So even if we don't know what it is, it's always there. And so we think about, as in practice, we might say, I'm going to do this particular intervention, and I know I should expect certain outcomes. Well, that's a theory. And I think that what we have done is make theory far too elusive, and we've made conceptual models far too elusive to people, and it sounds like it's really, really complicated, and it's not really, really complicated. Well, maybe it's not for me because I've been dealing with it for so many years, but I'm seeing that my mission in all the writing I've done for many, many, many years is to make all of this somewhat more simple. And as I've worked over the years, I've realized that I can't just write about what these things are. I have to find examples. And so my latest book, which came out, published by Springer a few months ago, is all about how you apply conceptual models. And there's lots and lots and lots of examples. And so we have the so-called atheoretical work to borrow theories. And this is where I think we got into a lot of trouble in nursing from my particular perspective, politically and in terms of professionalization of our discipline, in that we've thought that the theories that have been developed in sociology and psychology and biology and physiology and so on were like, that's what we should be using. Well, what does that say about that? Does that suggest that we don't have our own body of knowledge? So we're rejecting our own body of knowledge in favor of the knowledge of other disciplines, and that to me is a sign of people perceiving themselves as oppressed. And I think that's really unfortunate, because personally, I've never felt oppressed or perceived myself as oppressed. I understand that many nurses do, so one of my other challenges of my own career is to help nurses to understand that we are not oppressed, and that we may perceive that, we may, as Carol Anderson wrote in an editorial several years ago, that we tolerate a culture of oppression, but we don't need to do that. And I'm not coming at that just as a female and from a feminist perspective, but none of us need to feel that way, because we're really not oppressed. And if people think that they're the oppressor, well, that's unfortunate for them to think that. But we behave in many ways as if we're oppressed, so we don't speak out. We don't participate in policy making. We don't participate sufficiently in politics, and we continue to borrow theories. The interesting thing is that when we test theories that we borrow from other disciplines within the context of nursing, which means in the context of people who come to nurses for their services, who have particular health conditions, a lot of the time the theory is rejected. And so one of the earliest examples I knew was when I was at the University of Pennsylvania many years ago. My colleague Barbara Lowry was very interested in testing a theory of attribution, which essentially is from social psychology, and the theory purports that for everything that happens to people, there's a cause, and the people can attribute cause. So the theory tended to be tested what Gene Johnson once called two-legged sophomore rats, in other words, college students. And so the researchers would ask, well, why did you succeed on this examination, or why did you fail the examination? And there would always be some cause for that. Students would always be able to say, well, I didn't study enough, or I studied a lot, or you know, the test was easy, or the test was really hard, and the professor didn't teach me all the things I'm supposed to know on this exam. So there was always some cause for how you did on the exam, whether it was whether you were successful or not. And Barbara tested the theory in many different health conditions, and one of them that particularly struck me was that she asked people who had retired from the military or were veterans of being in the military and now had arthritis, how they got arthritis. And almost everybody said, I don't know. And she asked very probing questions that would go along with the attribution theory, and like, well, you know, like, what do you think happened? Was it something that happened inside you or something out there? And the veterans continued to say, I don't know. I just got arthritis. I have no idea how I got this. And so a very central proposition of attribution theory was not supported. So what does that say? Well, it says that that theory doesn't work for us. So borrowing that theory is not a very good thing. And what we need to do is pay more attention, if we insist on borrowing theories, is to test those theories. And the other thing is, if we're going to borrow a theory, because we say that, why would we reinvent the wheel, so to speak, and develop a theory in nursing that there's already a perfectly good theory that's been developed in sociology or psychology or whatever, that then we have to connect that with a conceptual model of nursing so that we can justify why we're even interested in that theory. So Lowry hadn't gotten to that point because I wasn't thinking about how to connect borrowed theories to conceptual models at that time. If Barbara were still with us, unfortunately she died a few years ago, I would be having that conversation with her now. And so then we started talking about shared theories. And shared theories would be theories that we borrowed from other disciplines, and unlike Barbara Lowry's work, we found to be appropriate for nursing context. And what we're doing mostly now, or at least some of us are doing, are generating and testing distinctive nursological theories that are derived from conceptual models of nursology. And that's the big challenge, is to do that. So there are many, many, many theories that have already been derived from the conceptual models of nursing that I mentioned earlier, and I'm sure that there's a lot more that we're working on. So although much of what we do appears to be a theoretical, as I've already mentioned, that we've progressed to borrowed and shared theories. And now, as I mentioned, our major challenge is really generating and testing distinctive nursological theories that are derived directly from conceptual models of nursology. So for example, most of my research since 1979 has been based on the Roy adaptation model. And so I've developed theories directly derived from the Roy adaptation model of a theory of adaptation to childbirth, and a theory of most recently a theory of adaptation to infertility. So nursologists do not believe that they should connect their theories, development efforts, to conceptual models of nursing is, as Popper said, absurd. So in other words, it's absurd to think that we don't make those connections. So as you can see, Popper has really become my hero. And then to go on to empirical challenges, we've gone from, in nursing, pretty much a love affair with quantitative methods, which is in many ways a heritage of so many of our nurses getting their research doctorates in other disciplines before we had many PhD programs in nursing. And a lot of that work is quantitative. And then we've gone to quantitative versus qualitative methods. And so we had the so-called paradigm wars that existed in, at least in the United States, for several years. And in most recent years, we've come to realize that we can have both. And that's called mixed method research. And Creswell and Plano Clark have been among the most well-published and well-known of the mixed methods people outside of nursing, but their work is very relevant to nursing. And it occurred to me maybe a year or two ago that what we do in practice is invisible nursing research, and it's mixed methods research. So when we're going to go to a patient, so before we walk into the room, we may look at the electronic health record or the chart or whatever that might be, and we tend to look at laboratory values and any other information that might be available. So we begin to form a picture of this patient, and then what do we do when we walk into the patient's room? The first thing that we generally say to a person is, how are you feeling today? So there you've got a qualitative piece and a quantitative piece. And then we somehow put that together and we integrate that, and that's what mixed methods research is. And sometimes we put more attention to the quantitative portion. So we think the laboratory values are more important than the patient saying how he or she feels today. And other times we think that the qualitative portion of how the person says he or she feels today is more important than what the laboratory values are. And sometimes it's equal. And the last two, quan plus qual and qual plus con, just means which comes first. So if you would start, for example, by going to the patient and saying, how are you feeling today? The patient says, good, bad, horrible, terrific, have a headache, pain, you know, where the surgery was, it really hurts a lot right now, or I'm feeling really good and I'm ready to jump out of bed, or whatever it might be, then you might want to look at the lab values and decide whether those are consistent with what the patient is telling you. So essentially, I've already talked about this and this. And so what do we do then to pull all this together? We create conceptual, theoretical, empirical structures. And when we're going from a conceptual, theoretical, empirical structure, another pulling all of this together, from a qualitative perspective, we identify the conceptual model. We identify the relevant conceptual model concepts for whatever question we're asking. Then we link those concepts to empirical research methods. And each of the conceptual models that I mentioned earlier, and a couple others, the transition framework and the synergy framework, I've developed what I call research methodologies based upon what I've read in the literature and what I've read in the original work by the theorist who developed that conceptual model. So saying, this is what the research should look like. This is what the design should look like, what the samples, the research participants should be, how we should collect the data, how we should interpret the data. And so in a qualitative or theory generating kind of inductive way, we need to go from the conceptual model to the empirical research methods. And then the methods give us the data and we generate the new theory. And that looks like this. And this is an example of a study of feelings about self derived from Roy's adaptation model. And here we see that that the Roy adaptation model self-concept mode of adaptation, which has two parts, the physical self and the personal self, that led to identification of a simple descriptive research design. Interviews were used to collect the data from 24 women with a medical diagnosis of chronic renal disease who were receiving hemodialysis at a clinic in Brazil, and content analysis was used to analyze the qualitative data. And from that was generated a theory of feelings about self, and the two dimensions or components of the theory were sexual dysfunction and low self-esteem. And so that came out of those data. And this is an example from my new book. And to the extent that I could, I used examples that were published in the literature. So this is a real-life example of a publication using the Roy model. So I didn't invent this one. And then if we're doing theory testing research, it's a quantitative deductive approach. So again, we identify the conceptual model that we're going to use. We identify the relevant concepts of the conceptual model. And then we link those concepts with theory concepts, and then link the theory concepts with empirical research methods. And so this is an example of this. And this was a quasi-experimental one-group pre-test, post-test research design. And so the research participants were 60 upper division baccalaureate nursing students who happened to be in two different courses. And so they, the researchers linked the Newman systems model concept of prevention as intervention, specifically primary prevention, with a theory concept, essentially the experimental treatment, simulated conflict management training exercises. And they measured that by a protocol that described what these exercises were going to be. And so it was standardized, so everybody got the same information. And then they theorized that the that these exercises would result in, from the Newman systems model, strengthening of the flexible line of defense, which is a metaphorical line in the Newman systems model that prevents the breakthrough of stressors for people having symptoms. And so they said that the outcomes would be of the intervention would be what they call stress resiliency, and they had an instrument called the stress resiliency profile that measured that, and psychological empowerment, and they had an instrument that measured psychological empowerment, and then conflict management style, and they had an instrument and another assessment tool to measure conflict management style. And they used pair t-tests to test their hypotheses. So here, in ending, I would like to say that that what we need to do in terms of our empirical challenges is to recognize that research is done for the sake of theory development. And I found in one of the best behavioral sciences research texts by Fred Kurlinger many years ago, a tiny little footnote that read that we do research to develop theory. Aha, you know, we don't do research just to do research. We do research to develop theory. So by theory development, we mean we generate new theories and we test existing theories or theories that we've derived from conceptual models. And then I took it a step further more recently and had this kind of aha moment myself to say that, oh, the research findings are the theory. So that when we read a research report, we read maybe explicitly what the theory that was to be tested was, but probably not, because not too many of us actually name the theory as we're doing it. But then the findings are the theory that has emerged from the data, whether it's qualitative data or quantitative data. The research findings are the theory. And when we're talking about evidence-based practice or evidence-informed practice, then the theory is the evidence. There are other forms of evidence, such as tenacity, which is we've always done it this way, authority, that the textbook or the instructor or somebody who's regarded as authority tells us to do it this way, a priori, which is common sense. But most people think that the theory, which is developed through research, is the best evidence. And so that's what I really have to think about as our challenges. So thank you very, very much. Merci, Gertrude.